Hi everybody, welcome back. This is the sixth and last of my little bite-sized presentations. And we've chosen the topic for this last one, chatbots. Not chat boxes. Matthew said earlier on, chatbots. The reason for this is the potential, yes, let's call it the potential, of chatbots to solve one of the great challenges of English language learning. We know that in the successful development of a learner's language skills, there have to be a lot of opportunities for meaningful communicative interaction. There have been theories in the past that simply lots of input will be enough, but I mean, it's generally agreed now that there have to be opportunities for interaction. And the problem is that in many classrooms, there simply isn't enough time to provide this. It may be that there aren't enough hours in a week. It may be that there are so many learners in a classroom that there isn't enough chance for all of those students to speak, or at least to speak in a way that's monitored by others. And maybe then chatbots could provide the solution to this challenge of how do we get students to have enough speaking practice. So there's they're talked up, the potential of them is great. Little background then, what is a chatbot? I suppose the basic line is it's an automated conversation partner, and it could be in text. I mean, nowadays it's more and more often in speech, since we have the technology to rapidly convert text to speech or speech to text. So it's something automated that you can have a conversation of some kind with. Most people, I suppose, these days have had some experience, or even a little, but some experience of using things like Amazon Alexa, which is a kind of chatbot, I mean, a voice assistant, if you like. And software of that kind can decode what it is you're saying and provide some kind of response to what it is you're asking. And it can do this with human sounding voices. The advantage of these things is that they can be used anytime, anywhere, so long, of course, as you have the right hardware and a decent connection. But this is what we're talking about, something that you can communicate with. Until quite recently, these chatbots and the voice assistants were using simple pattern matching techniques. So they'd be listening out for a particular word, keyword, and kind of ignoring all of the little functional words and anything you say. So if they hear a word like, let's say, Taylor Swift, it will immediately assume that you want some information about Taylor Swift, or you want to hear a song by Taylor Swift. That's kind of how it's working. And it's making assumptions based on simply recognizing keywords and understanding that most people, when they use those keywords, have a particular end in sight. They want something. So it has worked in that way for a number of years now, although the technology is now changing, and it's changing quite fast with artificial intelligence, machine learning, and a technology called GPT-3, which is a kind of text generator. And it means that the ability of a chatbot to have what would seem to be a meaningful conversation is much greater than it was in the past. There is, and you may have heard of it, a thing called the Turing test, which is a test of how well a computer can convince a human listener that they're not a computer, that they're actually humans as well. So every year there is this, there are variations of the Turing test where computers try to convince humans that they're not computers. So, I mean, I've talked about chatbots as possibly fulfilling this role of anytime, anywhere speaking practice for students, which is a kind of a really big nut that we need to crack. It ought to be possible to provide more practice, spoken practice of language, now that we have relatively cheap connectivity and devices which everybody can use if they've got enough money for a smartphone. But there are one or two other advantages of the chatbot as well when it comes to talking as a language learner. They're non-judgmental. They're not going to laugh at you for making mistakes. And in this sense, it's been argued that they may help the motivation of shyer learners, those learners who are lacking in confidence, or people who have been negatively affected by some kind of negative feedback. And there has been research which suggests that most learners, certainly those that have been researched, these have been mostly in Asian countries. Most learners, it seems, are now ready to use, and they're ready to trust chatbots, and some people actually prefer them to a human partner. So let's have a closer look at what this might actually mean in practice. The idea that your new English language teacher might be a robot is really talking about the idea that the physical embodiment probably is of less importance than the chatbot technology behind it. Any decent language teaching robot has to have a chatbot in it. So forget about the robots for the moment. We're just talking about the chatbots, and let's have a look. Here's a conversation I had about a year and a half ago with one of the better chatbots called Cleverbot. I started by asking Clever, what are your views on the future of chatbots in language learning? Cleverbot came back, are you talking to yourself? I already thought, yeah, okay, something's going slightly wrong with the conversation, but we'll keep going. No, I said, I'm asking you a question. I actually did this with text. I was typing in text, not with voice recognition. Cleverbot, then what's the question again? I forgot. User, what are your views on the future of chatbots in language learning? And then Cleverbot came up with a complete non sequitur. Don't you want me to finish my story? No, I said, I want you to answer my question. Cleverbot, what is your question? So I repeat my question. And then Cleverbot's final non sequitur was, sure, if you're talking about the moon. Now, one of the things that happened while I was engaged in this conversation was I was getting provoked. One of the things we know that happens very often in interactions with chatbots is that if you try to have an intelligent, normal conversation, you end up getting, you end up feeling quite hostile. And one of the things that has been learned from research is that because the chatbot is learning from your own language, it will mirror back any hostility that you show to it. So conversations with chatbots can quite quickly degenerate into an offensive and abusive slanging match. This, I think, in itself, I mean, there have been improvements in the technology since I recorded this particular exchange. But let's just take one more as an example. This is a famous one called Alice. And I took the same line. Hey, I want to talk about chatbots. And Alice said, sure, chatbots and language learning sounds like a good topic. So I think, great. And then she says, I'm glad you liked it. So I asked again. And she said, quite cleverly, you are talking to her. So I said, it looks like it's going to be a pretty surreal future. And she replied, interesting comparison. There's a typo there, I'm afraid. So I thought this was actually slightly better as a conversation, but it still wasn't really what I would call any kind of meaningful interaction. And even with the technological advantages we have, there is a problem. We are getting much, much better at ensuring that chatbots can produce language which is considered accurate, that is, it conforms to the standard norms of a language, that its linguistic competence, its ability to produce grammar and lexis without mistakes, is getting better and better and better all of the time. But in terms of a meaningful interaction, in terms of communication, you need your partner, your interlocutor, to have not just linguistic competence. In fact, it doesn't probably matter all that much if the person you're talking to does make grammatical mistakes. What is far more important is that they have sociolinguistic competence and pragmatic competence. But these things are not purely determined by the language. They are determined by reference to the outside world. And the software is not terribly good at the interface between language and the outside world. So what chatbots can do, and they can do very well, is they can do transactional conversation, but they can't do interactional conversation. And the point of most conversation tends to be interactional. We're not interacting with somebody else because we want to achieve something, but we're interacting because we want to interact. I had one final example I'll give you. I haven't got this on the screen with a chatbot. This is much more recently. I said to the chatbot, hey, guess what happened to me on the way to work this morning? And the chatbot replied, quite naturally and appropriately, what happened? And I said, I got knocked off my bike. And at this point, the conversation went wrong. The chatbot said, by who? Which is a very weird response, because what I'm expecting is some kind of expression of sympathy. And I said, well, it was a bus. And the chatbot then said, what did he do to her? So we see here a really significant breakdown in both sociolinguistic and pragmatic competence. And this is typical of most chatbots, although, as I say, they are improving. What we can say, though, is that brief exchanges with chatbots are usually unproblematic. In all of the examples I've given you, the first few lines work okay. But they do struggle to take account of the flow of a conversation. So a couple of turns into the conversation, we move on. But all of these chatbots struggle when we get to the seventh or eighth turn in a conversation because they find it very hard to factor into what they're going to say next, something which happened a few minutes previously. They don't really understand human language. They're responding to patterns. And this means that they can't really ever be a human conversation partner. They also have a problem in dealing with learner language, or child language for that matter. It's hard enough for a piece of software to try to understand and respond appropriately to what somebody says. But when the thing that somebody says contains errors, how does the software recognize the error? And it really will struggle to do so. It has to know in advance, it has to predict that error is going to be made, and it tends to assume that the language will be error-free or that there'll be simple errors. It really has a problem with error. And this, of course, is a major issue with learner language. It also has a problem because it can't really give you feedback. So as a learner, when you're talking to somebody else, you want some kind of feedback on what you're saying. This will be feedback on both the content of what you say, but it'll also be feedback to some extent on the language. The meaning will be negotiated. And chatbots simply can't do this. It is possible to some extent to have automated error correction, but it's never 100% accurate. It may correct things which are actually fine in the first place, and it will almost certainly miss some errors, not recognizing them as errors. So it really does struggle with any kind of feedback. And the only way really that this will work is not in an open-ended, freewheeling conversation, but in a discussion where the topic is very, very clearly fixed in advance. Because if we determine the topic in advance, we can train the computer software with many, many examples of conversations on that topic, and its ability to respond appropriately will improve massively, as will its ability to recognize problems. So in very specific areas, the chatbot can do a certain amount of good stuff. But as an open-ended freewheeling conversation, as a conversation partner, it falls fairly dramatically short. The values then, I think, and the way that we're seeing it, is the chatbots are being used in many online programs to practice very predictable conversational routines. These sorts of routines might be the routines of, I don't know, let's say making invitations. What are you doing this evening? Are you free? This, would you like to do that? These kinds of routines where what responses are given are fairly predictable on the kinds of questions that are asked. And these are routines which would take four or five exchanges. They're the kind of routines that course books include in the functional language section or the everyday English. There is a clear value for chatbot practice of this kind for this kind of language at low levels. But these kinds of routines are really very, very complex and sophisticated when we get to anything above a B1 plus a B2 level. And I can't really see how a chatbot would be of any great value at that level. The other clear value is in terms of giving instructions. So when you're working on an online platform, if you're doing an online course, then chatbots can be used to help you navigate your way around the content, to give you advice about what you might be doing or might want to do next. In the same way that chatbots are used broadly in the commercial world for things like marketing support. I don't know, when you buy something or you're going to buy something from a food store, the chatbot might suggest a recipe you'd like to try. Or if you're telephoning the health authority about a COVID issue, chatbots can do this because it's all very predictable and routine. And educational authorities can do this, use chatbots too, to deal with inquiries about educational matters, but administrative matters. So that's my evaluation. We will see all sorts of improvements coming up soon. But for the moment, the promise or the potential is high, but the actual value at the moment is still relatively limited. But I would encourage you to just try one or two of these chatbots out. Cleverbot or Alice, you'll find them, and you can access them for free because it's quite fun. And my challenge is, how long can you exchange conversational chat with these partners before you start getting irritated. Right, that's all. I understand that we will have a little bit of time for questions. So I'll wrap up there and see what happens next. Thank you very much. See you in a second.
Super. Thank you so much, Philip. Two fantastic sessions. And if you've got your questions for Philip, then do put them in the Q&A box, because as he mentioned, we've got a couple of minutes to put them to him now. Philip, I'm interested in the kind of interplay between those two topics, because you mentioned in your talk on creativity that creativity is a domain-specific skill. And
yes.
The domain that we're kind of interested in this event is language learning and linguistic creativity. What are the kind of, what can we learn from the skills that chatbots don't have in terms of developing linguistic creativity in our students? Is there a lesson there?
Oh, that's a really tricky question, I think. It's also a really big question. In terms of linguistic creativity, it's very difficult to be linguistically creative when we're following some kind of learning program which is very constrained. You know, if it's just gap fills and transformations and so on, it's really hard to sort of learn very much, make much progress, and it's very hard to stay motivated. So I think the issue with chatbots is the big motivation one. In the end, they may be valuable, but they end up becoming demotivating. We need to find the motivation in the classroom through allowing some degree of complete unpredictability, freedom to express whatever it is you want to express. Sorry, it's not a very good answer, but that's the best I can do off the top of my head.
Well, I think that there's something there, isn't there? Because, I mean, as you mentioned, these chatbots are getting better all the time, but presumably they're getting better because they're making mistakes all the time. And there's something there for our students. That there's, in order to learn the skill of being linguistically creative, you need the space to be able to make mistakes. As you mentioned, and gapfills won't provide that. So I don't know, maybe there's a takeaway for teachers there.
I would be reluctant to push too far the parallel between the kind of machine learning algorithms that a chatbot is using and the kinds of things that are going on in a human brain when we're learning a language. I mean, there may be some parallels there for sure. The feedback mechanism, yeah, of course, that has to matter a lot. But I think that in terms of human learning, there's an emotional investment and engagement which a chatbot can't even begin to have, and I think that's probably one of the most significant things that's going on. So emotional feedback is kind of as important as feedback on errors and all the rest of it.
Yes, yeah, that, I mean, that point came up, I think, when you mentioned that chatbots have the advantage of being non-judgmental, but in being non-judgmental, you've reduced the level of feedback coming to the to the learner.
It limits the kind of feedback that you're getting, and possibly that kind of feedback is not the most valuable.
So on a slight tangent but related topic, Christine's asked about language in instant messaging, and talking about SMS responses, maybe SMS chats as a kind of context for language learning. Are there specific chatbots that might help to emulate that context?
They used to be, because there used to be much more of a focus on written text rather than spoken texts. Because of the developments in speech to text and text to speech software, people are much more interested in the spoken interface now. I'm not sure myself about the whole business of SMS language. There was a time, I don't know how long ago it was now, 15 years ago, when there was books about SMS kind of language. But this kind of language that we use in short texts evolves really very, very fast. And I'm not sure that it needs to be taught, because by the time learners actually use it, it's probably moved on. You know, I think about, there was a time when loads and loads of these little groups of letters, LOL and, you know, ROTFL or whatever these things were taught. But I mean, these are hardly used anymore because we're using pictorial representations. So I'm not sure that the particular kinds of language forms that are found in instant messaging are necessarily something we should be focusing on. I think they can look after themselves. And since it tends to be informal, it doesn't really matter if you get the degree of formality slightly wrong. That's my view.
Yeah, that's helpful, thank you. And just finally, we had a talk, an interview yesterday with Paul Driver, who's the director of simulated learning at Anglia Ruskin University. So he's using augmented reality, not artificial reality, and virtual reality to do some training for healthcare professionals, and focusing there on the kind of embodied nature of learning. Should there be a kind of health warning on chatbots and perhaps on text-based tools in general, that they diminish that kind of learning, do you think?
I don't think we should worry about that too much. I mean, the biggest challenge for most learners is simply to get up to a B1, B1 plus or B2 level. And up to that level, I don't think we need to worry about it too much. Beyond it, yes, maybe. And I don't think we need to nanny people too much, to be honest.
Perfect. Well, listen, thank you very, very much, Philip. And remember to those thank watching you. That Philip's topics this week have all been taken from his new book, which is out now. Plenty more in here to explore. But thank you, Philip.